The following program contains scenes of full clothing, pointless time wasting, cold calling, and 25% participation marks, which may not be suitable for all students and Asians. Viewer discretion is advised.
And if I'm wasting my time, then nothing could be better.
Hello class, my name is Professor Brent McKnight, and I will be your professor for Commerce 4 PA 3. This is Business Policy and Strategic Management. Now in this class you will learn absolutely nothing new, absolutely nothing. You're just going to be focusing on applying what you've learned so far throughout the semester. We're going to be doing case analysis every single class. Every single class. And I repeat. Now, this course is administered by our great leader, Dr. Nick Bontis, ladies and gentlemen.
All hail the leader.
Okay, so since this is the first class, we're just going to start off introducing each other. Just say something very brief, interesting about yourself, and we'll just start off with you over here.
My name is Joe. I enjoy long walks on the beach and tweaking my decision on capsin all throughout the night.
My name is Ming, and my favorite art is Enrique Iglesias.
Would you dance?
No, my name is Jin. I'm master of origami.
Guys, my name is Seamus.
Alright, kids, that's enough. That's enough. We don't need any more any interesting things about each other. We're done here. We're done here. Alright, thank you. Thank you. And we'll move on. Alright, so for this next portion of the course, every week we're going to have a little new segment where you just basically waste time for the first 10 minutes, bring up any news that you see is relevant. It doesn't really matter where it's from, it's just a waste time, get the full 3 hours in. So does anyone have any relevant news from the past week or so? Anyone? Come on. All right, Eddie.
Well, the Jays just finished up spring training, and they've scheduled Ari Dickey to start the home opener.
Well, that's not really relevant to business. But we'll talk about it for 5 minutes anyway. So does anyone have any comments? Oh, Seamus?
Yeah, you know, that was a great trade by the Jays to pick up Dickey. Anytime you pick up a player from last year who won the Cy Young Award, you know, you're going to do well. So, yeah, my 2 cents.
You know, a lot of people say I kind of resemble R.A. Dickey a little bit, but I think it's because I toss a lot of knuckleballs on tests personally. So... So moving on to the next part of the class, we're going to do a case analysis on prestige worldwide. So, Claire, can I please have you toss out the handouts right now? Claire, come on. Wake up.
Guys, simmer down now. Come on, you guys are being very talkative. I know it's the first class, but you got to get on focus here and read the case. Come on, guys, you're still being very talkative. Let's get on task.
All right, so now that you guys have read the case, we're going to do an initial situational analysis. So let's start off with, who are we? All right, so does anybody have any ideas? Come on, guys. Jen?
I didn't need the case.
Are you kidding me? Anyone else? Me?
Steve, why?
Well, that's great that you got the company's name right. Does anyone else have anything else to add to this? Any bit of analysis? Seamus?
Yeah, I think we're a sensor company. You know, we used to be a monopoly, and then the government broke us up into six different companies. You know, exact same market share, exact same operating systems and everything. And now we're just all vying for increased market share, you know, to make the industry more competitive.
Very good, very good. So now we're going to move on to a strategy triangle here. So we're going to look at basically the business plan of the company, and we're going to look at their goals, their product market focus, their core activities, and the value proposition, what they want to add to the customers. Okay, so does anyone have any goals for this company here?
Yeah, they're striving to be the leader in market share within the industry.
Okay. Yeah, Joe?
They're also wanting to become competitive cost-wise by becoming automated. Cost leadership, possibly.
Cost leadership. Good. Very good. Eddie?
I got something for under core activities. So.
Okay, so we'll skip down here.
Yeah.
And...
So some of the activities include research and development, production of the sensors, you got human resources, financing, and marketing.
Okay, so basically just all the basic functions of a company.
Nice one, Eddie.
Okay, so anything else? Yeah, go ahead.
For the product market focus, they wanted to focus in all available five segments, a traditional, low, high, size, and performance.
Okay, so they wanted a great product width.
Yeah, they wanted to offer products in all of the segments.
And also, they're focusing on selling to business, so business to business.
Okay, so business to business, perfect. B2B. Anything else? Okay, so does anyone else have any more goals? Yeah, I just want to get one or two more.
Yeah, I think that they mentioned that they want to become fully automated within the industry.
Well, automation kind of leads into that cost leadership, so just kind of reducing all your variable costs.
Okay.
Anyone else? Ming?
I think they also provide the highest cap, like they want to provide the highest cap or return on capital.
Okay, so highest return to shareholders. All right, perfect. That kind of wraps up the outer edges here. So we're going to work on the value proposition next. Anyone? Joe?
They wanted to become a well-rounded firm offering price-competitive products in all of the segments available.
Well, that pretty much sums it up perfectly, so I'm not even going to write it down. All right, so moving on, we're going to focus on Porter's Five Forces. Now, I know you guys haven't seen it before, so I'm just going to show you on the PowerPoint really quickly. So now we're going to move on to the next tool because you guys understood Porter's very well. So we're going to look at the performance matrix, which compares organizational health and organizational performance. And we're going to look at Prestige Worldwide's progression over the years throughout this diagram. So one by one, you guys are going to come up, kind of plot where they are for a different year, a different era. And we're just going to work our way through this matrix.
Okay, we're going to I'm going to look at round one. So because the firm had just split from a monopoly, it was in the earlier stages of becoming independent. So they had some issues forecasting what the next year's demand is going to be. So they based their forecasts completely on the computerized forecast. So their production wasn't lined up and their cash flow wasn't lined up. So basically, they actually retired about $8 million worth of bond, thinking that they had extra cash. And it actually resulted in a visit from Big L, so they did take out an emergency loan.
Not only that, their production was over the forecasted demand, over the actual demand, I mean. So they had inventory, and of course there was inventory carrying cost. So it started off in good 5 and 5 at T0. I think it went about one mark down to 4 at T1, to be continued.
Christine Worldwide realized after a long run that they were having the cash flow issues that they forget provided by Capsim system was not occurring. Therefore, anticipated unit sale was not aligned with the production, resulting in excess of the inventory and the inventory cost to alleviate cash flow problem. They issued the stock and the bond in total of $5.5 million and maximizing their training hours and the recruiting spent to the 80 hours. And 3,000 per employee. Therefore, health went up, but the performance remained relatively unchanged. Therefore, we put 6 and 4.
So when we find ourselves in round 3, we were in a state of crisis. And that was because, looking at the management preferences, we were frozen in our thoughts about the perceptual map and how we used it. We were doing it all wrong. And so that caused us to use all this money that we didn't have in spending, and it forced our performance down to about a 3. And also that had effects on our health, which then ended up to health being at a 3 as well. So ended up being in a state of crisis. Yes, moving on to round 4.
So due to the actions of round 3, the organization needed to recover in some way. So to do that, emergency loans were paid back, forecasting became on track, as well as it resulting in efficient production. And this remained consistent through rounds 4 through 7. Furthermore, the buying back of capacity started the turnaround for our organization, leading them towards the desired state, and I'm out.
Alright, so in round 8, they actually had about $80 million in surplus cash, which they actually decided to pay out mostly as dividends. To, I guess, keep their assets low and to, I guess, maximize their return on asset. Their stock price actually has surpassed about more than $300, and their market capitalization was top in their industry of 6. They also had full plant utilization, so they almost maximized their capacity, and their turnover was actually excellent as well. So that brings us to a very, very healthy organization of, we would call, 99 in the desired state. And that is Prestige Worldwide.
Okay, class, so that was a very good discussion on the performance matrix. You guys correctly identified their path through the performance matrix as the organization progressed through the years. So now just to summarize the course, or summarize this case analysis, I want you guys to mention what you took away from this class and what you learned.
Okay, Joe, go ahead.
We learned that it is important not to rely 100% on the automated forecast. It is also really important to understand, to study and analyze your previous performance and your previous demand and your actual sales and the growth to develop the numbers that are relevant to your industry to make proper production decisions and cash flow decisions.
Perfect. Well done. Seamus, go ahead.
Yeah, specifically for Capsim, an initial investment in automation, although in the short run it might prove negative and detrimental to your performance, that initial investment will prove beneficial in the long term because you'll have low costs and you're fairly highly automated.
Good point. Anyone else? Ming, go ahead.
Well, I think the airline industry is very, very competitive.
Claire!
Claire!